Saying no telling how many hours. And I used to mow off all the pastures, all the hay ground with it and everything. I've even mowed the hillsides down here that we don't even farm anymore. I used old Anna the Mule, which we talked about a while ago, and Kate was usually the two that I used most of the time. And after old Anna passed away, I used Joe and Jim were the pair of mules we used to it. So it's been over the farm many and many times. Now this is the old hay rake we use after we cut the hay down. We'd rake it up, we put what's called a windrow. Then after we got the windrows, we'd go through and shock it. Then we'd take the wagon and the mules and go through and load it on it and haul it off from one corner of the field up here in what's called an orchard. There was one little high place up there. We always took a post hole digger, set some posts, and we'd set them up and we'd stack hay around it. We started at the bottom real big and just tapered in. We got to the top. We'd put 7 or 8 wagon loads in one hay because we didn't have enough of barn room. Then in the wintertime, we got barn room after stripped the back out. We'd go get the hay and start hauling it in. But the hay rake here was something that was really almost necessary to get the hay raked up in the rows where we could pick it up with a fork to load it on our wagons. I can remember I was real small when Dad bought them. Dad, he worked some, but his health was bad on him, and he couldn't do a whole lot of work. And that's why when I was 12 years old, that's when I pretty well worked on the farm just like a man. Except Mary and Helen, my two older sisters, they'd go out there, they worked, they run these hay ricks and mow machines same as I did. But after I got up, I was the one that had to do the work because I was the boy. But them girls, and they'd out there and they'd, stacking hay, they'd work on the wagon, which I'd always have to work up on the stack. But Mary and Helen was the one that done most of the hay work on the farm. Something or other that Mr. Flowers wanted Dad to do, and Dad said he would do it if he would, I don't remember now what it was, but he would do it if he'd teach him the music of the songs. He stumbled or something, and Dad went up there, and it's something about a blacksmith, it's something to make. I don't remember now what it was, but he told him, he says, I'll do it if you will teach me the music. Dad had a good voice, but he must have got lost where none of us children can sing. Used to, everywhere I'd go, they want me to lead the singing or sing. He said, well, you're a Flowers, you can sing. I said, I can carry a tune, in which I cannot. And the mill was sitting up there pretty close to where Bobby's house is now. It's just to the left of it as you stand there and look in. The gate to the other side went down into cane mill. And Dad worked for him for years and made every year he would get up every morning, go up there and make molasses. In the cemetery, my dad had made some of the tombstones out there. We got sand rocks right down here on down the hollow here from the house. We went down and dug them out and brought them up here, and he sat out there and took a chisel and a hammer, trimmed them out and made the tombstones. Well, he built it just like he'd build a tombstone. He'd take a rock maybe this wide and this long, and he cut a hole in the center of it and set the tombstone down in it, and one he had the names carved on it. It was approximately 4 inches thick, some maybe 3 to 4 inches thick, something like that. It's just a flat rock. And we busted it out, and we'd taken the two mules and pulled it up in the wood yard there where he worked on it. He made quite a few of them down here, and they wanted him to make some more, but he said it's too hard to find a rock that he could carve, for he didn't have the tools to carve a limestone rock, which is a whole lot harder than a sand rock. You can see the pitch of the roof. It's on a 45, and that is steep. And at one time, it's covered with shingles. In fact, I helped my dad build, split out the shingles to cover it one time. Then they all rotted off, and we put the roof on it. And as we put the roof on it back in about the 50s and 60s when the roof was put on it. The shingles was made out of oak. What they usually use was they go to the cut an oak and they go up there and get one this year. We call them water oaks or black oak, for they always would split straight. You cut them off in blocks about approximately 2 foot long. That's what a shingle was. And you cut it up in slabs. Slabs would be just about this thick and just about this wide. And you start on one side, you start in with a, we had what they call a throw. And we'd bust them out and split them out there and let them dry. And we've got a lot of tobacco sticks too that Dad, there's still some up at the barn on top of the hill that he cut them out of hickory. He'd split the log, he'd cut them 4.5 foot long, split it up in squares, and he'd take that throw and make tobacco sticks out of it. And there's quite a few of them up there right now, still in the barn, that were used made out of white hickory. But now you've got to have a straight log, no knots in it, anything, to get them to split out straight. This is what we use to make shingles with. We take it like this, and we had square blocks of wood just about it. We take them all, and drive it down in it. Well, that's rotten, it's breaking out. You turn it this way, it'll cause it to run in. You pull it this way, it'll cause it to run out. And that's the way you got a straight shingle when you bursted it. There I'm through.
Now, those belong, can you say
yep.
that?
These belong to Dad. Dad made this. Now, you can look here, you can tell he's blacksmith. Here where is one piece of metal, he wrapped it around. And he did all he used was a solder, and it's welded through the heat. Get the heat to certain out, and now they take electric welder to weld them. But he farmed this out in the blacksmith shop up there in the barn. And you can see there, you can hardly tell where the seams are or anything. And this blade here was real sharp, and we used it. And that's a hickory handle to make it stronger, and this is a hickory maul, which is made this way because that's what they use to drive the, I called it a throw. Now, some other people may have other names for it. But that's what we always called it. Fish and clean them. I've sat there and helped Dad clean over 100 them little catfish, about anywhere from 12 to 14 inches long. And we'd fix them. And if we couldn't eat them all, she'd cook them in canners so they wouldn't spoil. We didn't have no refrigerator. It was up in the 50s, we never got a refrigerator. And we got a kerosene refrigerator, which we used here before we had electricity. Electricity was put here in this house is in the 50s. But down the late 49s and early 50s was when we had the kerosene refrigerator. We'd put kerosene in it, and that's the way it done. It done better in the spring, for we always had to take our milk up to the spring and put it in a, what you call a milk box in the spring. And we went to have a meal, one of the girls would go up and get, so they knew which one to bring, which bucket or jar to bring to the house, and that's when we had our milk. And I've ate many glasses of milk with cornbread in it. Boy, you take a big piece of cornbread and, yeah. And that's the reason why when I was going to the mill, I'd have to take a bushel and a half corn every week. We'd eat that much corn. She'd making cornbread and other things. And on the weekends of the mules, if we didn't work them during the week, we'd always ride the mules down to the lake. But if we worked the mules, Dad said, well, the mules need to rest. If we wanted to go to the lake, we had to walk. So we'd go that walk down to the lake. Dad was an expert with a gun or a pistol. He went out and he told us boys, y'all go out and come back in so I'll hear one gunshot so I want one, a squirrel or a rabbit one. For when he went out and he come in, you could count the shots, how many times he fired, that's how many he would come in with. I remember one time we was down here, we was going through the field over here to the back, and we was going out through there and Dad pulled out a little old .32 pistol. 5 shots he brought back from Germany with him at World War I, in which I have the pistol right now. A squirrel jumped up on a fence post, and he just ran down and shot it. It's 45 steps, and he shot it, and it just fell off. I was just a kid, and I run down there and picked it up. I said, Dad, you shot it in the head. He said, well, that's where I was born to shoot it.